بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. حديث number 270 in our series on عمدة الأحكام was narrated by جابر بن عبد الله بن حرام. May Allah be pleased with him and with his father. Who would volunteer to read this hadith, inshallah?
Narrated Jabir ibn Abdullah. I heard Allah's Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the year of the conquest of Mecca, saying, Allah and his Prophet prohibited the trade of alcohol, dead animals, pigs, and idols. People asked, O Allah's Prophet, what about the fat of dead animals? For it is used for greasing the boats and the hide. And people use it for light. He said, no, it is prohibited. Allah's Prophet further said, may Allah curse the Jews. For when Allah made the fat prohibited for them, they melted the fat and sold it and ate its price.
Jazakallah khair. Now this hadith of Jabir ibn Abdullah, may Allah be pleased with him and with his father, includes a lot of points that we should take a look at. First of all, the conquest of Mecca happened in the 8th year of Hijrah. And in that, the Prophet ﷺ mentioned a number of prohibited things. And he said that these following things are haram. The first one he started with, alcohol. Actually, the word used is khamr. And khamr is referred to wine. But when someone comes and says that, okay, the Prophet prohibited wine. Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned in the Quran, wine. So it's okay to drink beer or whiskey or different types of alcoholic beverages, as they call it. So is this permissible or not? I said, no, because the Prophet said, alayhi salam, and he clarified this to us in the Sunnah, and he said, whatever a large quantity intoxicates you, then the smallest of it would become haram. So whether it is wine, whether it is whiskey, whether it is a vodka or tequila or scotch or whatever they call, all of this is forbidden and haram. Whether it is heroin, cocaine, crack, meth, it is all haram because they all intoxicate. And without any doubt, intoxications are harmful for any normal person. And that is why among the disbelievers, there are a lot who do not drink. Why? Because they know that this is harmful. So logically, it is forbidden. Now, what is the beginning of the hadith? The Prophet said, Allah Azza wa Jal has made forbidden. Then the prohibition comes from whom? Only from Allah and the Prophet who conveys Allah's laws to us. So prohibition of something is not for you and me. It is for Allah Azza wa Jal. It's a serious thing. Then the Prophet mentions, alayhi salatu salam, the dead animals. What do you mean by the dead animals? Meaning that anything that is not slaughtered. Now, in Islam, all animals, birds, cannot be consumed unless we slaughter them and the blood flow, and we mention Allah's name. So these are the two conditions in normal slaughtering. There is something that is not normal, which is hunting a game. So you have to say Bismillah and you shoot something that penetrates. But this is also will come in the chapter dealing with hunting, inshallah. If I come and I find a very big, beautiful cow, dead, it died. Heart attack, high cholesterol, blood pressure, it's not my business, it's dead. Is it slaughtered? No. Can we do CPR? It's dead, khalas, it's gone. So, okay, a lot of meat. Can we eat it? No, this is dead meat. Haram, dead meat. Okay, can we use the liver? No, it is completely prohibited. The whole thing is dead. And the difference of opinion of the skin, can we use it after tanning it or not? And this is not the place. We mentioned this in the very early beginning of the book of Tahara. What about the things that come out of it that is not part of it? such as the wool, the things that can be cut and it's not alive because of it. This is, inshallah, pure and permissible for you to use. The third thing that the Prophet ﷺ mentioned was the pigs. The pig, the swine, the animal itself is totally prohibited for Muslims. Everything? Or can we use the milk, for example? Ya akhi, anything dealing with pigs is completely prohibited for Muslims because it is totally prohibited for Muslims to consume it and to eat it. The following thing the Prophet mentioned was the idols. Now, what is the word used by the Prophet ﷺ in the hadith? The Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wal asnam, the plural of sanam. What is the difference between sanam and wathan? You know, sanam and wathan. In Arabic, wathan, anything that is worshipped other than Allah Azza wa Jal. Sanam, anything that is worshipped other than Allah but has the form of a human being, an animal, etc. So rocks are awthan, but an idol is a sanam. So the Prophet is mentioning anything, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that is worshipped other than Allah, it is prohibited for you to sell or to buy. And this includes also not necessarily things that have the form of a statue, also anything that is worshipped, such as the cross. The cross is considered to be a wathan. And that is why when Adi ibn Hatim, may Allah be pleased with him, came and accepted Islam, the Prophet told him, alayhi salam, remove this wathan from your neck. And he was wearing a cross. So it is not permissible to wear or to sell or to buy crosses and anything that relates to idol worshipping. And then the Prophet ﷺ was asked, now you told us that Allah made these things forbidden. What about the fat we get from dead animals? Okay, we did not slaughter them. The animal is dead. If I collect the fat, I can use it. Now the Prophet is talking ﷺ in the very beginning. What did he say? Allah has made forbidden the price. So selling it is prohibited. So the companions were asking, okay, Aslam, now there are things that we can make benefit of. We use the fat of dead animals can be used in greasing the ships. Ships were made of wood. So greasing it means that the water would not come in, would not leak. So we use it, and also we use it in lighting the candles and lamps, etc. So is it permissible? The Prophet said, ﷺ, no, it is prohibited. And then the Prophet said, ﷺ, may Allah kill the Jews. Now the Prophet ﷺ is making dua, and the dua is against the Jews. Why? The Prophet justified this by saying that when Allah Azza wa Jal made things forbidden upon them, they twisted Allah's laws, trying to make a trick to make things become halal. So Allah forbade this thing for them. So they made a trick, sold it, and consumed the price of it or the cost of it. And this is against what Allah Azza wa Jal has made forbidden to them. This is called al-hiyal, or tricking, doing tricks so that you can bypass, can cross, can do something that Allah Azza wa Jal has made forbidden. For example, on the Sabbath, Allah Azza wa Jal forbade the Jews to work, and they were overlooking the sea and they were fishermen. Only on the Sabbath they will get the fish coming. Allah forbade them from fishing on Sabbath. What did they do? They went on Friday, they dug ditches in the sea so that when the fish come on the Sabbath, they're stuck, they cannot go out. And on Sunday, they would collect this fish. So they made a trick. What did Allah Azza wa Jal do to them? Transmuted them into apes and swines as a punishment. So this is extremely forbidden. And likewise, You can tell from this hadith that Allah is blocking the means that lead to haram. Because they were asking, what is the ruling on using and utilizing this fat? And scholars differed. Some of them said, were they, when the Prophet said, no. Was he referring to selling the fat or using the fat? Scholars differed. Some of them said, no is to use the fat. You're not allowed to use the fat of dead animals because this would lead to selling it and consuming its cost. Other scholars say, no, the Prophet prohibited السلام, selling it, but he did not prohibit using it. So if you have a dead animal and you take the fat and use it for greasing the boats or for using it to light the house, this is permissible. Selling it to someone else and getting the money of it, this is haram. And the majority say that no, using it and selling it is forbidden, and this is a choice of Sheikh Abdul Aziz Ibn Baz and other great scholars, the majority, and it appears to be the most authentic opinion, just to be on the safe side, though Sheikh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah and other scholars say that no, you can use it, but you must not sell it. So to be on the safe side, forbid using it and selling it as well. We have a short break, stay tuned, and inshallah we'll be right back. Assalamu alaikum and welcome back. Now, among the things that we learn from this hadith is blocking the means. What is blocking the means? There are things that are haram for themselves. So it is haram to eat dead meat. It's haram to drink alcohol. And there are things that lead to haram. So Allah is blocking the means by forbidding them. For example, being alone with a woman. The third person with you is shaitan. So, ya akhi, I can't be alone with a woman, nothing happens. Yes, it is a possibility. But this is one of the means of something bad to happen. So Allah is blocking it. Looking at the opposite sex and enjoying it. May or may not something that result out of it. Yet, Allah Azza wa Jal is blocking the means for us. Blocking the means from something worse from happening. I see the idols and I curse them. But the idol worshippers would curse Allah. Is this permissible for me to curse them? No, you have to stop that. Building a masjid on top of a grave. This would lead to worshipping the grave after a while. From the hadith, we also learn that tricking Allah Azza wa Jal is one of the major sins. Because if you sin directly, is much easier than making a trick to sin, as if you're fooling who? You're fooling Allah. Astaghfirullah. This is even worse. No, sin directly rather than do a trick to fool Allah the Almighty. Nowadays, we find a lot of the names are changed so that they would make sin acceptable. So, alcohol, intoxicants, what do they call it? Spiritual drinks, spirits, they call it. When you have nudity, when you have music, when you have free mixing in the movies, what they call it? They call it art. If you go to banks, riba, one of the major sins in Islam, they never call it riba. You never go to a Muslim bank where they're dealing in riba and say, yes, I'll give you a loan 100,000 for a riba of 10,000. What he would say? For interest. They would call it interest. I'll give you a loan for interest. Interest is much softer than riba. So changing the names is what they are doing nowadays. I believe that this covers almost what's in the hadith. So we open the floor for questions. Yes, Akhi.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Salam.
Sale of dead animals is prohibited in Islam. What about dead fishes?
Akhi, this is a very good question. It is excluded from the prohibition, as the Prophet said in the authentic hadith, alayhi salatu wasalam. There are two dead animals that are permitted for us and two blood permitted for us. The two dead animals are the fish and the locust. And the two bloods are the liver and the spleen. So this is exempted from the general prohibition. Any dead fish is permitted for us to eat, meaning that I'm traveling on the sea and I find a whale dead and on top of the water. It's dead. I didn't fish it. I didn't kill it. Can I eat it? Yes, you can. And the companions of the Prophet ﷺ did this when they came a place close to Jeddah and they found a whale and they were starving. They were traveling and there's no food. So they said that they ate from that whale for a whole month and they took a big whale. And they said that they erected some of its ribs and they went through it with a camel, which means it's a huge fish. So anything that lives entirely in the ocean that cannot live outside of the water is halal. Whether it's dead or it is alive, you can consume that. That's a very good question. Yes, Akhi.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Sam.
As we have learned in the last session that we cannot purchase or sell anything which is not measured.
Measured, yes.
That you have given the example of rice, a pile of rice. But when we go to the market, take for example of tomatoes, there will be a heap of tomatoes and the person will sell it in kgs. And at the end of the time, when the market gets closed, there will be some tomatoes remain. And if you take back to his home, it will get spoiled. And he says now, I will sell this tomato for XYZ price. Can we purchase that tomatoes because it is not measured now? And if he take back to the home, it will get spoiled. And when we purchase it, and it will be the win-win situation for the both the sides. Even he will be happy and we also.
This is an issue of dispute. And the most authentic opinion is that you can sell it due to the fact that there is mutual agreement and there would not be any dispute about it. Generally, you cannot sell the tomatoes until you measure it. So your measuring cup should also be matching his measuring cup. So him saying to you that this is 100 kg is not sufficient before you yourself measure it. And this is happening on most places where they have big scales and you buy it off the scale. You can see it, it's been measured. Now in the pile, in the issue of piles, if there is no ambiguity, and as you mentioned, this is permissible, even in normal conditions, but you have to collect it. You must not sell it until you actually possess it and collect it. And Allah Azza wa Jalla knows best.
My question is related to the real estate regarding the possession of the land. I buy a land from a farmer or someone and I plan the land. I plan the roads, I plan the houses, place for houses. And I say to the farmer that I will pay you in installments. I possess the land. Now I will sell the land and collect the money and pay in installments to that farmer. So is it allowed in Islam?
Yes, the minute the transaction had taken place and you possessed the merchandise, whether it's land or a car or food stuff, you're entitled to do whatever you want because the agreement was done on the first day. I'll buy this land from you for $1 million. I'll give you the price over a duration of 3 years. What I do with it is not your business. Khalas, I bought it. And he said, I sold it. So you can either cultivate it, you can sell it to someone else and get for it maybe 500,000 and keep on paying in installments and you hope that you get some money later on. This is not our business. The business is, he sold it, you bought it, it's yours. You can do whatever you want with it.
Assalamu alaikum.
Salam.
If a person worships a tree, is it haram for me to sell him a tree?
Definitely, if a person worships anything, this is shirk. You participating in anything that facilitates or helps him is forbidden. Likewise, if someone makes wine and you have a farm of grapes and he comes to you and says, I'd like to buy from you 200 kgs of grapes, it is prohibited for you to sell it for him. If someone smokes and he comes to your shop and you know that he smokes and he wants to buy a lighter or matches, and you're sure, he tells you, please give me matches so that I can light my cigarette. It is prohibited for you to collaborate or to assist him in that.
Sheikh, it's a question about ownership. That if I'm a part owner of any commodity, do I have the right to sell that to someone else? Like, for example, if there is a vehicle that which I own and I'm paying the payment in installments and I'm not still the complete owner of this vehicle, can I sell it to other party? Do I have the right for this? And associated with it is that, can I transfer the loan on him? Like, you pay the payment now and you give me back my payment, how much ever I have paid till date.
Now, this is complicated. Let me answer your first question. If you are a part owner in a property or vehicle, you cannot sell it to someone else until your partner approves of it. If it's undefined, meaning he has 50% in the car, I have 50% in the car, and someone else wants to buy it from me, my 50%. This is not defined, the 50% in a car. Is it defined? You have two wheels, I have two wheels. You have the engine, I have the trunk. No, it is mixed. So this we will come, inshallah, to discuss. It's called a shuf'a, meaning I cannot sell my undefined portion of something without going back to my partner. And if I do, if I go to the brother and say, listen, I'll sell you my 50% for 10,000. And he gives me the 10,000, or we agree. My partner has the right Islamically to overrule the third person who paid the 10,000, and I will tell him, this is your 10,000, leave. He said, no, I don't want to leave, I want my part. He said, no, it's not your right, khalas, anymore. And the partner who sold has no right to say, oh, if this is the case, if I'm not going to sell it to my friend, then I'm not going to sell. Again, he has no right, because this is the right of the second partner who will be, we will get to talk about this, inshallah. As for your second question, we will postpone this because I believe that we are out of time. Until we meet next time, fi amanillah, wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.